should a grace age believer's mental fortification come? Where do we gain the help we need when it comes to weathering disheartening physical prognosis, let's say, for example, that's entered our personal world? Where do we gain that fortifying stability of the mind? It could be any tragic circumstance that comes your way, happened, no matter how it comes along. How did God design that believers be bolstered? Let's put it that way. When things come into their lives that knock them off their feet, and that happens. It's probably happened in your life. It's happened in mine. Some believers think that support should come from the pastor. After all, he's the one who's supposed to be the specialist in all matters spiritual, right? And how those spiritual matters relate to the physical. Unfortunately, that's how a lot of folk, religious folk, reason it. Why, the pastor's the one. No matter the situation, the pastor is the one who's supposed to have the biblical information necessary to bring stability to whatever destabilizing condition a believer's found himself in. Not all that long ago, a church search committee sent out an application in hopes of filling a void they had at the pastor position. A friend of mine received that application in the mail. He read it, wide-eyed, and handed it to me and said, "Would you look at this application for a pastor here?" What he found in the cover letter was that this assembly was actually seeking a full-time pastor who was willing to take a part-time outside job. They wanted a person who would be willing to work outside the assembly to supplement the meager amount they would be able to give him. As I said, he gave that application to me to look over and give him my thoughts. I was amazed at the number of things this assembly expected of this prospective new pastor, who was to work at least 20 hours each week outside the assembly in addition to all the things they asked him to do. He was to teach Sunday morning. He was to teach Sunday evening. He was to teach a Wednesday night or lead a Wednesday night evening prayer meeting. He was to be ultimately in direct oversight of all the youth Sunday school activities and the youth group activities for that assembly of all ages. He was the main man. He would be expected to visit each member of the assembly either at that member's home or at his home on a timely basis. And he would be responsible to conduct a certain number of shut-in, hospital, and or nursing home visitations as a regular part of his pastoral schedule. I shouldn't have told you folks these things. On top of all this, he was to receive an initial job evaluation at 6 months service and yearly thereafter. And to be considered as a part of that evaluation process would be the number of new members that had come into that fellowship and former members who had departed that fellowship during the time of that new pastor's tenure. Wow, now he's responsible for how many new members we get and how many members we lose. For those interested, the answer was no. He didn't take that job or even bother to return the application. But you see, these folks, in addition to all the other things they wanted their pastor to do, thought it's only appropriate that this man be on call 24 hours a day in case a church member should happen to need his emotional, spiritual support should a crisis of some sort arise in their lives. Well, when you think about it, the overseer of an assembly should indeed be one with a proper understanding of doctrine. He should certainly be capable of giving appropriate advice and counsel and whatever emotional support he can provide to the members of his congregation who seek it from him. But Paul makes an interesting statement in his letter to the Grace Age saints at Rome, where he states in Romans 12:15, "Rejoice with them that do rejoice." Do what? "Weep with them that weep." I believe that a person seeking the office of an elder, which is the same thing, the role of the pastor, should have a spirit little less of empathy and compassion. That would be weep with them that weep and rejoice with them that rejoice. Think about Paul's exhortation in the book of Colossians, where he states in Colossians 3:12, "Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy," splankton in the Greek, "spleens of mercy, filtering out the bad, storing up the good, kindness." Kindness and compassion go hand in hand. In fact, compassion is a synonym for the word kindness in your thesaurus, as well as the word empathy. Responsiveness is a synonym for the word empathy. So the idea wrapped up in all of those words, folks, is that of supporting one another, the supporting role that we're to play with one another. The members of the body of Christ are to be the supporting cast of the body of Christ. What I'm trying to show you here is that when Paul said in Romans, rejoice with them that do rejoice, weep with them that weep, he was addressing these words not just to the pastors in the pulpits. He was addressing these words to the people in the pews, because this letter was written to the saints, not to the pastors. Notice the address of his exhortation to be empathetic in Romans 1:7. To how many? All that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. Not just to pastors, but all. The same is true of his exhortation to put on bowels of mercies and kindness. The exhortation appears in Colossians, but Paul addressed that letter to all the saints which are in Colossae. We should be supporting one another. That's the idea here. We should be here for one another. This isn't a job reserved solely for the pastor of an assembly. Paul wrote in Ephesians 4:16, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in what? In love. It comes right back to love, does it not? Wrapped up in that word edify is the idea of bolstering, reinforcing someone when they're down and out, encouraging other people, supporting them, augmenting them, shoring them up, strengthening is the idea here. Saints are to be doing these things for saints. And hopefully that title fits the pastor of the assembly as well. But what I'm trying to show you is that this isn't a role reserved for the pastor. This role belongs equally to those who sit in the pews. There are times when the physical presence of another believer, especially, is helpful to a suffering saint. There are times when it isn't. There are times when saints want to be left alone. There are times when holding the hand of a suffering saint is welcomed. There are times when it's not. Just being there in times of distress can be comforting to a suffering saint who's seeking that type of support. Some saints would rather have solitude. A prayer.